I'm Kalev Kuklane, and I'm the head of the Thermal Environment Laboratory. We are quite a small research group, two senior researchers, me and Sean Sigal. Later, Sean Sigal will show, if we have time, show you a gate lab where we study balance and slip and fall accidents. Then we have doctoral students, Karin Lundgren, Kovnatsky, who just graduated, did studies on climate change and heat effects. And Amitava Halder, who is doing on balanceability and musculoskeletal effects of motion. And then Jakob Pettersson is a new doctoral student who is working also on climate change, and we are developing, he's working in a project where we are developing personal advice related to climate, the weather broadcast. Combine weather broadcast with your personal input and then personal recommendations what to take care of during certain day. And then we usually have also one guest doctoral student. So at the moment we have a person, Robert Toma, from Brno Technical University from Czech Republic. And he's doing the mannequin measurements, measuring clothing insulation and evaporative resistances. But that will be a little bit more about later. So this house, it is a Department of Design Sciences, and it's called Ingvar Kamprad Design Center. As we got Lund Technical University got a big donation from IKEA founder Ingvar Kamprad, and based on that money, a big part of that money was then used to build this house. And the idea was to collect different subjects and studies that may support design process. So it is a Department of Design Sciences, and we have the Education of Engineers, and we have a School of Industrial Design. These are the research areas in the house: innovation technology, industrial design, of course, product development. This is more like technical design. Here is, in a way, maybe more soft, how things look, that people accept it, that it works. And here is, in a way, the calculations that it actually does. Packaging logistics. Working environment technology, and our group is a part of working environment technology, and aerosol technology and rehabilitation technology. So, the laboratories in the house. We have aerosol laboratory. Today you don't visit that, but as it's always interesting how particles work in different environments, so we are planning to have more cooperation with aerosol, so we may combine our lab facilities. Virtual reality laboratory, it's also a study related to firefighters on tunnel rescue, where people are moving around and then you are in the virtual environment looking and trying to find a way, and what is the decision making, creating the stress as in real conditions. However, there is no thermal stress involved there. So thermal environment laboratory we will visit later, that you hear more about. Gate laboratory we visit as well. We have also laboratory for vision and lighting. Usability laboratory, where we can test how people, if they get a new product, how they use it, what are their expectations, what goes wrong. Mechanics laboratory is robots. Additive manufacturing workshop, we can print out stuff in 3D. Full-scale laboratory, it's together with architecture house. We can build up the whole, in a way, interior and then test how people like it. Mechanical workshops, we're lucky ones, always generally cut down, but as we have the design students here who need to make the things, so we have managed to keep our mechanical workshop. And then we have also student workshops for different materials. Thermal laboratory, we have two climatic chambers. One is a warm chamber, and the other one is cold chamber. We can create the temperatures in the warm chamber from +5 to +60 degrees. Relative humidity, we can change from 10 to 90%, but of course it depends on the temperatures. And create with the fan, chamber fans, air velocities from 0.1 to 0.7 meter per second. However, if we would put in other types of fans, we can get also up to 10 meter per second, but that is very turbulent, so 10 meter per second is an average, plus minus 3 meter per second, depending on the location and point. Cold chamber, we can go up to from plus 20 down to minus 40 degrees if people are working in. If we have we're testing materials, then we could go to minus 50, because when people work, they generate heat, and that is an extra load that the, today the chamber can't manage, because we can't, in a way, fill as we like the cooling media into this system. Then we have to change the system. And we have a removable middle wall, so we, if we like, we can have a big cold or big warm chamber. Equipment. We are using thermal mannequins. Thermal mannequins can be the body parts or the whole body mannequin, so we can dress up and measure the insulation of the clothing, evaporative resistance of the clothing, so that also the design aspect of the clothing comes into account. If testing materials, we don't have the shape of the human body, but on the mannequins, we can study it. And then body part mannequins, hand, foot, head, so we can look in more detail in certain areas. Of course, as our work is related, it is one is technical measurements, other one is human testing, and the third part is mathematical modeling. Then we do physiological testing. In when body works, we generate heat. We have to take it into account, and then we have to measure oxygen consumption in order to know exactly how much heat is generated in the body. So from the physiological point of view, we can do also the test, sports testing related studies, measure the maximal capacity and similar.
Just on that question, do you work within some sort of international parameters when you're using human research?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, because I can imagine you would put them under some stresses.
Yes. We will see later specific studies what we have done. Yes. In some cases, it can be also, how to say, all tests what we do, we are the subjects first. We do the pre-testing. So we know what happens, we can adjust it, and we don't want to go over limits. And then, of course, everybody has been doing the first aid program. So if something happens, we are ready for that. So if I look this 15 years plus what we have been here in this house, then we have nothing has happened except one day we had a student lab. And in one laboration, two students, in a way, got heat syncope. So we just one and other after another. So it happens, but it's like it can happen that in same day, in a way, it's the same hour with two persons. System for temperature measurements. We can measure environment, we can measure skin temperature, we can measure body core temperatures. And the systems are also both for in-lab use, but also the field equipment. Air velocity measuring instruments, system for humidity measurements, different weighing scales. We can measure human with accuracy of plus minus 5 grams. Clothes, so we know how much has been evaporating, how much has been condensating, in which layers, how much moisture has been condensating. So we can, in a way, give the recommendation of changes of the clothes. Or, And then we can have also some samples with 0.01 gram accuracy measuring small quantities. For physical exercise, we have treadmill, we have a bicycle ergometer, and we have also, what is missing here is a step mill. And then we have also solar lamp to generate heat load. So thermal mannequins and other thermal models, we have been testing close insulation, evaporative resistance. We can, based on these parameters, we can evaluate different environments, working situations. Hand model to measure gloves. There are special international standards we are able to follow. In many cases, we are also, in a way, joining the standardization work as experts and helping to develop the standards. Our facilities can be used to look effects of thermal environment on human health, function, performance and comfort. Development of models for risk assessment related to thermal stress and strain. Strategies for prevention and the elimination of thermal risks and problems. We work with models and methods for evaluation of heat transfer processes. And work also with ergonomic aspects of design and use of personal protective equipment. Design of environments and products with optimal thermal properties and function is quite important part of our work. As said, we are involved in international standardization work, both CEN and ISO level. And also, of course, we are experts in CIS. Experiments are carried out in with humans and climatic chamber. Both we cover a whole range, as I showed, from heat to cold, and performance of human performance in work is the most important aspect. It's also physiological responses that is important, but also how, what are the subjective sensation. In some cases, there are not very big changes in physiological parameters, while the subjective sensation is changing a lot. And then also physical measurements of heat transfer are quite important part of the work. In addition to the lab conditions, we do also the measurements in the field. We have the equipment. So here is one study from northern Sweden where we looked on works in dairy farms where they have open sheds where cows can go in and out, and then we were looking on the thermal conditions of the workers there. And now I show some examples. Later I will focus mainly on these studies, what we have done on firefighters, related to firefighting. Here are some other studies related to different aspects, so you get the width of the what we can do. So because the firefighters' work today is not firefighters' work, it's rescue services, so you can be out in any weather. So we are looking on cold protective clothing. We have been working also with the disaster medicine department, for example, in Umeå, where we looked at different ways of protecting the casualties during cold season, which types of blankets, which types of wind protection are most effective for keeping a patient warm. We have been active also in developing, improving the sleeping bag standard. that is also the standard that we used for disaster medicine, the material insulation and evaporation resistance measurements. We are looking also on thermal responses to mild body cooling, how different body parts, when your cooling reaction starts, how it functions, and based on this, looking on possibilities, how we can improve equipment to keep people at comfort. For cold, also auxiliary heating devices have been looked. It can be the packages or today also the electrical heating. The batteries have become pretty light, so you can easily utilize them. Let's say, electrical heating is not a new one. It's already 60s, 80s. We've done a lot of work. However, the most biggest issue was a battery. You couldn't carry that battery with you. To keep you warm, it's mainly was related that okay, you are sitting in a car and connected to the car battery, and then you could keep warm. But today, the battery power in a very small batteries is already enough. Protection of hands in cold, testing different gloves, looking also on performance in different gloves. What is the handwork performance? Cold protective footwear. Shuanxi Gao will show the gate lab, and then it slips and falls in cold climate and on different surfaces. But also we have done, this ramp was developed specially to look at roof workers. What is the risk of slipping, falling on roofs, angles, what materials, how the shoe soling works together. Then closer to heat, humidity and heat radiation, solar heat. It was a big project called Therm Protect, where we looked how the moisture moves from body out, how moist clothing affects the insulation, how it affects under the radiation, the heat load. Work in heat. Another protection, it's the for medical, protective clothing, how long you can work in different conditions with different layers of protection, how good the protection has to be in order to work as long as possible. And here is also the ventilation solutions of the clothing, human responses in here, heat with different predictive models. Effects of climate change has been very popular recently. And then several rescue services related studies on, for example, on breathing frequency, what are the effectiveness of filters when you have different flow rates, and also ice vests or exposure to heat. I will, about this study, I will talk a little bit more. And then finally, it has been also very much about smart solutions in the clothing, and then is a question of different evaluations, what data you can get in, how you use it. Okay, that is the background, and now is a little bit more into details. Do you have any questions on the previous part? No? Okay, the outline. I take a little bit background about the human capacity, a few words. Then a study on comparison of three sets of turnout gear, effects of ice vest, phase change material, hybrid cooling things, what I call PCM plus, what we tested, but there are other options as well. Then ventilation effects in clothes. And then a little bit about smart solutions. Now coming back to what do firefighters desire from the next generation of personal protective equipment? It's Seoul National University, Professor Lee has together with colleagues from Japan, US and Australia done a quite big extensive questionnaire study and asking what is actually what firefighters themselves want to have. And then number one is a location monitoring system, an automatic body cooling system, a wireless communication system and vision support system, what firefighters themselves point out. There were quite a big list also of those what they absolutely don't want to have. I haven't listed it, and a little bit our research is related in this area and body cooling systems. So, human heat exchange. In any work, the body generates heat. Even if we are sleeping, we have a basic metabolic rate, and that heat we have to get rid of, and it's convection, radiation, heat exchange, evaporation, even through respiration we lose or exchange the heat. Clothing, protective clothing especially, with its thermal insulation and vapor resistance, is affecting the heat exchange with the environment. So in order to keep human at thermal balance, then heat storage should be zero. We have a metabolic heat production, mechanical work, and then heat exchanges. All heat exchanges, depending on conditions, can be positive or negative. If we consider work in heat, then quite often we get more heat, let's say from radiation sources, while then evaporation has to compensate it. Metabolic rates, there are available tables we can estimate. Resting, it is a seated resting, it's about 65 watts per square meter. And then for different activity classes, it goes grows. In firefighter work, quite often it happens that there are short periods of very high activity where we have 600 watts per square meter. Continuous work for 50 up to 15 minutes is 475 watts per square meter, and continuous work up to 2 hours without breaks is 400. So in average, it's quite often between these, but not seldom, let's say climbing the tower 600 is not an issue. If we look on elite sportsmen, the maximum levels can be for that they can contain for longer periods is also 1,000 watts per square meter. These are specific cases. The highest is actually cross-country skiers. Yes?
Is that per square meter body surface?
Body surface, yes. Let's say a person like me, a little bit round and not so tall, it's about two square meters. And this average male or standard male, according to standard, it is around 1.8 square meters. It's used in calculations, but there are special equations based on weight and height. You can estimate it.
So roughly speaking, during those short periods, generating 1,000 watts.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yes. Now, what is the effect of clothing? We can see that now these are the change, increase in metabolic rate depending on the clothing. And we can see that even the best clothing would add 5% of them on the metabolic rate. What means 5% extra on the heat production. We see also gray fire, gold fire, it's 15%, but we can see also it is a little bit individual, so it is standard deviation, so up to 20% you can increase the metabolic rate. That means that this 20% heat load means that you actually can be 20% less effective with the tasks intended to be done. This is also, in a way, task-related. If we look on obstacle course, it doesn't have to be that the same clothing is working the same way. So it is a design aspect, how the clothing have been designed. But we have to consider that all the protection requirements we have. And quite often, those protection requirements define what materials will the manufacturers use. On the other hand, the maximal protection is not always optimal protection for the task. Looking on how the weight distribution affects the increase in metabolic rate, the worse is to add the weight to the legs. So you have to lift them each time, so that is an extra loss of productivity in a way. So ankles are the worst. The next one, if you have something in your hands, you have to move, lift them, and at waist, it's less effect. If the body heat is not disposed, then so if we have a person totally encapsulated, so each 100 watts we can consider adds 1 degree if it collects in the body. So elite cross-country skiing, as I said, 100 watts raises 10 degrees per hour.
Watts per square meter or 100 watts overall?
This is watts.
Okay.
Yes. But let's say Bjørn Dæhlie, Gunde Svan, they could have top athletes. They could easily keep 1,000 watts per square meter as well, quite long time during the marathon. If we compare Bjørn Dæhlie outside the season, he had 96 milliliters per kilogram per minute oxygen consumption. Let's say elite football players lay around 60. Normal people are there 40, 50. Relatively well trained.
Relatively.
People think that some people think that they are training a lot, and some people say that they are not training at all, but actually, this is, in a way, their subjective evaluation. So we can say relatively well-trained. What happens in a human body when we are heating or cooling? So a normal core temperature is around 37 degrees. We are at thermal neutrality. Temperature raises to 38 under that time, occurs vasodilation. We open the blood vessels, especially in extremities. If we think about it, then from elbows to fingertips, from knees to toes, it is a quite big body area. Close to half of the body area is in these parts, and the extremities are, you know, helping us to regulate the heat. So vasodilation, first in extremities, then also in other body parts, and after that, when that heat dissipation is not enough, starts sweating. Insensible perspiration, it's always present, but then it starts more. We can reach 39 degrees temperature during very heavy work. At 40 degrees, we have failing temperature regulation, intolerable. It has been done studies in Denmark on sportsmen. So when their core temperature reaches around 40, 40, 0.5, they stop. They are very motivated people to continue, marathon runners, but at that point, either they have to lower the pace or they drop down. If we look at 38, this is in a way a border as well. In normal conditions, if the core temperature raises 38 degrees, they automatically slow down the working pace. In some cases, it's not possible, or if people are very motivated, they have some other stress factors that allow them to forget it, then they continue above. And if you're going above 38, eventually you don't have the full control anymore because you have passed that threshold. So maybe you don't, if you are not experienced, then you don't know that you are in a worse situation. And if it's above 41 degrees core temperature, it means change in body heat storage above 310 watt hours, then there is a risk for heat stroke and irreversible tissue damage.
Sir, Kalev, just a comment. The test that Stefan referred to when we simulated the instructor's works at the academy during heat conditions and full rest and whatever, we found that I think some of the instructors actually entered 40 plus degrees when it came to body core temperature. Not during the work, but actually 5, 10, even 15 or 20 minutes, half an hour after we came out of the heat, after we took off our clothes. So it's like boiling an egg. If you don't put it in ice cold water, it will still continue to cook. So what we found, we didn't find any high temperatures during the work, well, 39, but the 40 plus were found half an hour later.
Yes.
And if you leave people alone, if you let them go home or whatever, sit in the car and drive home, they are in a hurry, they might reach their highest temperatures half an hour later. So it's also...
Totally true. I will show the data. Maybe you can continue the lecture as well, because it's exactly the same. You have the heat that has come from outside in, then it is the skin... surface can cool down, while the heat inside, it's... starts moving still in both directions, in and out, and then you have a after race, yes? And the vice versa is, if there are people who have been dropping in the cold water, they bring them out and check the temperatures, yes, it's fine, but there is vasoconstriction, when blood vessels open up, it takes the cold blood from extremities into the center, and you have an after drop. The highest accidental hypothermia where a person has been, in a way, recovered has been 45.6. It's most of the cases they are, would be dead, in a way. It's a single lucky case.
In terms of just a question about body type, is there a difference in, say, a more slender person to a heavier weight person in terms of how their body deals with temperature variation? Given the same exposure?
Yes.
It depends. Let's say one issue is the body mass itself and inertia in the body. Yes, it works differently, because you have a higher mass to gain the heat, but later it takes longer time to get in a way off it, because your basal metabolic rate is also higher because of your body mass.
So I suppose the question would be, to sort of put it in context, in terms of being a firefighter and operating in high heat, would that be better suited, the better suited body type would be a thinner person or a thicker set person? Or does it depend on how long they work for? I mean, let me put it this way, another way, if we're doing training and we're trying to get some sort of sense of our students and their ability to keep them safe, would we be more worried about the person who is carrying extra weight or the more slender student when we expose them to the same amount of heat, or can't we make any distinction?
It's not so easy to tell. If we take a lightweight person and a heavyweight person, then let's say, carrying 20 kilos of a, if 100 kilo person carries 20 kilos, it is relatively smaller weight than if a 60 kilogram person carries the same 20 kilos. So the physical load is different. At the same time, that certainly that person who has to carry 120 kilos of total weight, the body generates more heat. But then it's also, what is the task? If you have to carry somebody out.
Well, let's imagine that, well, there's two ways of looking at this. There might be some a task involved, or there may just be observation involved inside a hot environment. So there is no task per se, apart from sitting there and accepting heat, for argument's sake.
In that case, it is, in a way, the larger body mass takes longer time to heat up. Okay. Yes.
Then a longer time to dissipate that heat afterwards.
Yes.
Yeah. Without intervention.
Without intervention, yes. In any clothing, as I said, it is... When we are selecting clothing for a task, there are different ergonomic requirements: thermal, freedom of movement, design, look, storing, feeling to touch, donning, doffing, and there are protection requirements. These are often difficult to combine due to the opposite demands. So. The issue is that in many cases, the manufacturers look at the maximal protection. And in some cases, it is good. On the other hand, the most of the tasks needs optimal protection. You don't have to be having such stiff clothes for most of the tasks. So we come to the logistics questions here. What you can afford. If you are going out for a, let's say, accident scene on the road, then you actually don't need all that heavy equipment on you. While, can you have at the same time also some lighter clothes, so if the alarm comes, you have to go to, there directly to fire scene, do you have the chance to change? It has been discussion. Do you have these lighter clothes for road rescue and heavier clothes, but then it comes, what are the finances of the fire departments or the communities to buy all that stuff? Yes.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I come from a hot country, so we struggle with this balance and dilemma constantly. And our firefighters will always defer to a uniform, to firefighting PPE, protective clothing, for inside structural fires, to the lightest possible, because most of the time they're not fighting fires. The problem is that if we do have an incident inside a burning building, which will be the same temperature as with, if it was in a colder climate, our guys do not have the same protection. And our organisation struggles to... Well, if we're trialling a new uniform, they hand it out to firefighters and go, trial this. And every time it comes back, they go, too hot. too hot, but they're not trialling it under the conditions of which would be the worst case scenario, which would be to be assaulted by an enormous amount of radiation inside a burning building. So we often end up with a substandard uniform at that extreme, right? So if we do have one of those incidents, our guys are not as well protected, and it's a really difficult balance.
Yes. At the same time, if you saw this slide, what I showed, what is the effect of this heavy clothing? If you get 20% more metabolic load, means generally you have 20% less capacity actually to perform the task.
Mm-hmm. Work by positive on the other hand, right, in like for us. So I'm also from a country. So it's like the department wants to get the maximum protection to the firefighters, right? So we choose the best PPE for the firefighters. And so regardless what the firefighters said during the opinion poll or the trial run, everybody says too hot. But the department said, look, we took no chances. So we go for the maximum protection. But as you said, most of the time, the people where they're working, it's not, they don't need that maximum protection. So in reality, most of the energy has been lost before they went into the fire because of such heat and high temperature. They have cold water temperature and reduces the working duration in the fire. So it's on the other side of the barrier.
Yeah, but I think our problem is that traditionally we've always had firefighters, like you said, dressed in the same uniform, protective uniform, whether they were at a motor vehicle accident, whether it was a structural fire, whether it was a bushfire, whether it was a hazmat incident, because traditionally we wanted to look professional and all wear the same gear. And one of our problems, well, the answer to it really is a logistical issue of we should wear the PPE that suits the environment we're going into and not wear it when it doesn't suit the environment we're going into. And we struggle with that. You know, we struggle it culturally and traditionally because officers will move onto the fire ground and go, why have you got your jacket off? And the answer should be because my jacket is designed to go inside a burning building and I'm not inside a burning building, therefore I've got my jacket off. And we really struggle. It's as simple as that quite often. But rather than struggle with the logistical issues of having the right PPC at the right time, it's much easier just to say, no, I want you to wear that all the time. Or we're just going to get a lighter uniform so that when you do have that incident inside a burning structure, when you do want to be well protected, we are less protected. You know, that's what I object to.
Can I add something to that? Do we have, I don't see, is there yes in the room?
No.
Because there's a huge debate on PPE in Poland, especially that we're now getting probably 4 times the money that we used to spend per single set. Now we're getting four times that, and it's being done in a rush and so on. So there's a one retired firefighter, fire officer who knows a great deal, really a great deal about PPE and functionality and so on, but he never asked him. So he sort of posts all the time on his blog examples, and he often posts Germany as an example, because especially at a mass incident, when you have like 100 firefighters, you see drone footage or something like that. Not everybody is wearing something else, but you see groups wearing different uniforms, and then there's the PHWs, and there's volunteers, and the paid firefighters, full-time firefighters. And sort of, our authorities are also concerned that we should all look the same, but we also have a saying, it can be shitty as long as it looks the same, sort of. This shouldn't be a goal as well. I mean, all those departments sort of selected their PPE based on their economical possibilities, but also probably they also sort of adopted that to the mission. What is the main? And of course, it can mean that in some cases they don't have the optimal protection, but it's interesting to see that at some places the practicality takes over the let's say the aesthetical impression.
For the first time in history, we're actually going to change that at the academy. It's being done as we speak. We figured out that our students spend like 1%, less than 1% of the time in fire conditions where that kind of protective clothing is needed. So we actually gonna equip our students with, let's call it, good clothing for surviving in Swedish outside climate.
Yeah.
And that's what they're gonna wear. Actually, let's talk about carpenter trousers, some Gore-Tex jacket with some fleece under if it's cold and not fleece, and t-shirts if it's summer. A small Pestle helmet, good enough for everything besides BA operation. That's their standard. That's what they're gonna have in the locker. And then, if the schedule says today we're gonna be do BA operations, they go to the storage. They pick up a piece of fire suit that fits them, and then they do their exercise, and then it goes directly to laundry.
Yeah.
So we're going to change all that.
I already have a pencil, but if you want to send me that fashion Swedish gear,
yes.
Okay.
2005, if I remember correctly, there was an accident in Norrköping where one firefighter, a young firefighter, died. And we got a task from work inspection to look if the clothing could be the cause of that accident.
That was due to overheating?
Yes, in a way, the person stayed in and nobody noticed that he's missing. And that could be that he was using, in a way, there. What we tested was this Swedish RB90 clothing, then it was Ari, new fire suit, and then he was wearing this Ari fire suit with also a training clothing under. It was meant to be used otherwise as t-shirt and shorts. And then we had a normal station uniform as a reference condition, so UV here. We started with 20 minutes bicycling at 25 degrees, so as a pre-work, and then putting on the bottles, and then going into the 55 degrees and walking 5 kilometers per hour on a treadmill, and we can see that the skin temperature changes. The skin temperature in all three suits are about the same. We see that the rectal temperature, it's the raise is about the same. So within that 30 minutes of the activity, the body heat generation, you don't have much difference of the clothing. There is a change in after race, in different clothing. And also how much effort it takes. So if we look at the underwear or heart rate, then it has less, but we see also that this RE, that is probably the whole system is totally less stiff. So you have, for the same activity, you have slightly less heart rate, which shows you that you have slightly lower stress level, while compared to this modified RE and RB90, they are very similar. So in a way, our conclusion was that during that 30 minutes exposure, it couldn't be the clothing that affect the person. It was some other errors. And in that case, it was that some person had come in after as an additional support, and officer being there was not informed. So he was looking that somebody is following him and didn't know that there is an extra person, and that guy had stayed behind. So he, yes.
You're familiar with McClelland's work? McClelland?
No.
Okay, well, there's no correlation between heart and heat. There's a number of studies, I can get them for you, but they're, you know, that correlation between the heart rate and heat stress doesn't exist.
There is.
Okay.
Yes. So I don't agree. But I will show, if I manage, this slide. The heart rate is also affected with many, many other issues. It is the work. It can be stress. It can be heat.
The thermal lag. The thermal lag you described earlier. That was well described by McClelland.
Yeah.
And basically, the heart rate goes right down, but the thermal stress is going right up. And there's no correlation between heart and heat stress.
I will show one slide on that especially. If we see here now the. For one subject who did the longest exposure, because all in the clothing, they the core temperature raised to 39, or they wished to stop, so all stopped earlier than 30 minutes. So we can see also this effect, what you said, it is skin temperature goes quickly down at the point of, but we can see also that the core temperature continues raising after that exposure.
Yes. Could you, from these figures, conclude that within the course of one breathing bottle, you could even wear a plastic suit?
How we mean plastic suit?
For heat build-up in your body, you doesn't matter what kind of suit, so you
plastic suit. If we
gold standard
rising with temperature, core temperature starts rising after 20 minutes, five so scientists and probably the time that you could be inside the building using breathing, right?
We have to consider that this is now continuous heat load of 55 degrees. If we look underwear here, underwear after entering, it goes, you have a buffering effect of this thick clothing that doesn't allow. So if you are going into fire, you have the radiation sources, then certainly a simple plastic suit or underwear don't help you against those risks. So you have a quick shoot. And here, at this point only, in a way, this evaporation, what is from the body, is compensating better. But if we would have a radiation source or higher temperature.
It was as a matter of speaking, of course, without radiation. Yeah. But just for the metabolics, yes, in the body, it doesn't matter what kind of
Yes, considering these clothing, they are about the same weight. So if you have 6 kilograms of clothing, you have 13 kilograms of bottles, so let's say 22 kilograms of stuff on you, then if you have this clothing now 500 grams more or less, then it doesn't matter besides that 22 kilograms extra what you are carrying, or the task you are doing, that is quite small. But we can see that if we could reduce the total weight or the stiffness of the clothing, you could reduce the metabolic load, what means less heat generation. Either you have a better condition, but I will come back to that also. Firefighters are a little bit like sportsmen. You give them better equipment, they run quicker. So finally, the heat generation is the same, but of course, what you can do with that for specific tasks is different, because you have, in a way, more effort possible to put into task. Yes.
Maybe I don't know if this is what Ricardo was after, but now is a big talk about pollution or cancerous substances coming through the fire suit. So there's a lot of talk, and I think there's research going on in making suits that are basically impregnable, so they don't breathe in and out. And what would the effect be of that kind of suit? The same thermal properties, but you can't breathe in and out, because if you could breathe out, you could.
Generally, if it's totally impermeable, it is not good.
No.
But I think these materials are one way they can let in air, but let out there, but not let stuff inside. I think the technology allows that.
Mm. Yeah, no, there's different projects doing different things.
I think Viking does that.
But there's like some of the actual trying, like
it reduces it. One direction is less, but it's still considerable. Yeah.
You still have porosity, and what you have is, you know, permeable barriers, and if it's permeable, gas is going to always be smaller than the liquids. Yeah. And so you're always going to have that exchange. So the issue now is the surface morphology, or the texture of these fabrics, are being spun to create, if you will, nanostructures, so that they better attract either, you know, ionically or through surface structure, grab more of the particulate, but you still have the gas exchange. And we still don't even know how you clean them, right? So there's a whole bunch of problems.
Yeah. But can you say that the more weight that you have on you, the less performance you have?
Generally, yes, because some of your energy is going on that, just carrying the weight. So the lighter equipment, in a way, gives the possibilities to put more effort into the task or perform the task quicker. But it's not only the weight. Like I said, also stiffness of the clothes. And if we look at this energy metabolism for the same study, when we are on a bicycle ergometer, in a way, here we can see the stiffness of the legs because you are not carrying on body weight, it's sitting, and it's only the leg motion. So underwear has this small effect only here, that or the, but if we are inside and walking with whole equipment, it's also this extra weight what you have to carry with you compared to underwear only. This is the underwear picture. And on the other hand, the metabolic rates, in a way, here we have no significant differences between all those three suits. So it's like here is the point where I wanted to say that actually, if we improve the equipment, then you will always be motivated to do the best. And in that case, you get the work quicker done, but you will perform maximally anyway. That's why, in a way, important is also to look how the body can be cooled. And then we have the cooling methods.
Did he not also, epinephrine was implicated in that heat stress?
Sorry?
Epinephrine was implicated in that heat stress. Those sports players were taking epinephrine.
Oh, that I didn't know from this.
Yeah, so a number of these sports players take epinephrine, which basically tells the your pituitary gland, basically, or hypothalamus, tells your hypothalamus that you're not as hot as you are, and then they have this big mass. And
That's always a problem if you enhance your performance with medicine. The same people going high mountains, they start taking the pills already before going just to keep the sickness down. And when it happens, you have no chance anymore to bring it down with anything because you are on the medicine already. So it's always the case if you take something extra. But let's say it is also a little bit the same effect if you go over, in a way, force you to go over your warning signals to perform more, then at a certain point you don't see it either. It's a psychologically, you push yourself over the limit, so you don't have to have a medicine. You just push over this limit that is difficult, and then it can happen that you don't notice when it's just fall down. So the effect of cooling with ice vest, we see that this ice vest is put on a t-shirt and a station uniform, because otherwise it would be too cool. And we see the effect of on core temperature, as we put the vest on already earlier, so we have effect already from the very beginning. But also there is some difference in the inclination of the lines. At the same time, when we look at the temperatures in the back is bottles. They press the ice closer to the skin, and in the chest, the temperatures are quite low. And then it can get closer to discomfort. At the same time, if we add some insulation under, we diminish the effect of ice cooling. The more insulation towards the body means more cooling goes to environment. So,
in the former sheet, what was the measurement of what the temperature?
Yeah, 38.5, yes. Yeah. We had also 30 minutes exposure here. Yes. We tested also the vests with on a thermal mannequin, the same set of clothing. If we look only on upper body, then we see that in average around 80 watts we can get out from this 1 kilo ice package. And if we look the whole body, that is whole body heat balance we are interested, because the heat is redistributed and cooling is also redistributed by blood flow. So for total body, it is about 40 watts positive effect. because of this local cooling, that might be smart to use phase change material. Ice is also phase change. It changes phase from ice to water. But PCM, then we can, with different additives, can be selected different melting points. For example, here is with 28 degrees. If we look with no jacket, we have quite big effect of this PCM vest that is also cooling the environment, not the body. If we have the firefighter jacket on top, more cooling is trapped inside. But this PCM vest, as it's 28, it doesn't create local discomfort. So you can have it generally on a t-shirt next to body. However, here we see that this effect, total body effect, is roughly about 10 watts only compared to ice. Looking at different melting points, if it's selecting the vest with 24 degrees, we have the big effect in the beginning that disappears because the temperature gradient is bigger, so it starts melting, so we get more out. However, and with 32, the effect is longer, but in a way it's lower. But the total heat or cooling, what we get out, is the same as the mass is the same. There can be different, slightly different number because the latent heat of some substance is a little bit different. However, if we consider the firefighter work, then generally this 60 minutes and then is of interest. So the lower, the better, but not zero. If we look, those measurements were carried out on a thermal mannequin. Here we see the difference, the effect of a cooling vest of this 28 on chest temperature. Here is the, we repeated the same procedure. We had a first cycling and then continued with walking. With the vest, people could manage all 30 minutes as well. This is then the chest temperature and the chest temperature with the vest. Looking at core temperature, it doesn't affect the core temperature so strongly. It's about the same raise. Again, the after effect makes a difference of half degree in core temperature. And that's already a considerable effect if you are close to pass out or not. Yes?
Couldn't that be very dangerous? Because if the core temperature is hardly changing and your skin temperature says to you that you are cold, then you might get the opinion that you are not warm while you are. So, in that sense.
That is a risk, yes.
In the sense
yes.
of feeling
yeah.
cold.
Yes.
That is really
true. Yeah. On the other hand, let's say that this is the same. Now, what are the most sensitive body parts of the human body parts? Very sensitive is here, back, neck, and face. So when you are going and having a breathing apparatus, you always get cool air in your face. You have always that effect. In this case, our subjects were most dissatisfied with. They didn't get any because we were measuring the metabolic rate with separate mask. So they didn't have any cooling in the face, and they, in a way, they said we could continue, but this was awful.
So what? When it all boils down, how important is just working off what Ricardo was saying? How important is surface temperature anyway, in terms of your overall health versus your internal temperature?
You mean the skin temperature?
Yeah, skin temperature. Yeah.
I mean, or is this the only one that matters? And if this is the only one that matters, why put on a cooling vest?
You have a better, quicker recovery afterwards, number one. Number two, the body heat storage is not only the core temperature. This is the mean body temperature that is weighed between. So in a way, when you, if we are talking about heat load in the body, it is the total of the weighed average of the core and the skin. But the core shows, because this core is the blood that goes from your center also to your brain. And that is quite important, what is actually your... So we were not very happy with the results of with just PCM, and we were considering that, okay, if we are using PCM, but can we use something else? Let's say evaporation, combine the effects. And then we, in order to consider the effect of 50 grams of water, we had also PCM with inside the plastic, not evaporation, but 50 grams of water in each package. Then PCM with vapor permeable membrane, a Gore-Tex membrane that allows evaporation onto outer side. And then we tested also the same conditions with firefighter layers, and some other tests were repeated as well. So here is the just a hot plate. Hot plate with the packages, hot plate with in plastic with packages, with the membrane, the same covered, and then we had also the same conditions with wetted. So how it affects evaporation. Yes, when we put the PCM stuff or ice vest on, we reduce the evaporation from that part because they are totally tight. And then we had some other material. It's comfort cooling technologies. You dip it, in the water, and then you put it on, so it evaporates. So we can see that what are the effects. So PCM, we have a strong effect in the beginning, and then it disappears. We have PCM in the plastic. It's a little bit more. It's per package. It's 50 grams more of the mass just to be heated, so it takes a little bit longer. But finally, they are quite quickly finished. While with membrane, the first melting effect is finished, and then it continues with the evaporation. So the effect, what it takes away when covering body part, is added because it's outside evaporating and cooling the still the body. And then we had a new membrane, so Gore-Tex from 20 years ago, and today it's about the same. There is no difference. If they say they have improved, that's the same. And this comfort cooling technology, it is also, in a way, at first it gets an effect of warming up the material, and then it continues. It can continue pretty long. However, when we look on the wet plate, in a way, it means that we have lost the evaporation of the from the skin directly, so it is a bare skin effect here. While if we put on the jacket, then all these evaporation effects go down. And if we consider, let's say, total energy of cooling under the four first hours, so this PCM combined with the membrane and water in that allows, it gives in most cases more. And this is the frozen. We have it in the package. The package is also in the freezer, so the water is frozen. So we have three cases. PCM, ice melting, PCM melting, and then water evaporating. So we can get more effect. And it's also that PCM then is not so cold towards the skin. It's next to the skin, and then is the water layer. So its possibilities are possible. But however, when we cover it, we see again all effects go down.
What is it, like 40 watts?
This is it's kilojoule. It's in energy terms, 40 kilojoules, and compared to 80. Another possibility to cool is ventilation. I don't cover this permeable clothes, but increase of possibilities for ventilation by design solutions or active ventilation with fans. if we have just the clothing that we open up and we have a measured on mannequin again, so air velocity is 1 meter per second. We open up all openings, the neck, so we can only with this increase the heat loss. However, insulation is reduced. However, it depends on the clothing design. In some cases, it doesn't work. A project related to ventilation, it was that we had students from Estonian Academy. We had a project on bicycle helmets, the ventilation effects, how to improve it. So we gave the lectures on what are the basics, how ventilation works, and they came up with the helmets of their own design. We tested them in wind tunnel. Bicycling is pretty well defined. You are going in one direction, or you are standing in probably in traffic where you have pedestrians, you have maybe 6 kilometers per hour. If you are bicycling fast, maybe 20 kilometers per hour in average. So we created in wind tunnel this airflow and measured the insulation. So in wind still, standing at traffic light, we have total insulation, the skull, the forehead. Here is the head is nude, so there is no hair in this case. And of course, nude head is in a way the lowest insulation, the best ventilation. However, if we add the air velocity, about 5.6 kilometers per hour, the order of this, which one is the best helmet, is changing. And we can see also that with some flow, some helmet is better than the nude head. Adding hair to the head changes again the situation. And when looking at the evaporative resistance, what means the when you are bicycling and need cooling. If you try bicycling during winter, maybe you don't need. It's good to have it insulating. However, when you're bicycling, getting sweaty, it's good to get rid of the moisture. Then we have, in a way, some, when during the dry test, they were close here. They are now, in a way, one of the best helmets. So, considering this, generally it was that the most important for bicycle helmet, it's not how many holes you have. If you have a hole here, they are connecting, your air comes in, goes out, and is not cooling your body. If you have a hole here, but there is no connecting channels, it just creates a plug that is insulating, you don't get cooling. So most important is good inlet, good outlet, and the channels connecting them. And then on top, if you like this 18th century ship hairdress or whatever, because it doesn't matter. In the same way, it can be looking also that we use this fan-ventilated clothing. Inlet is different position, and where are the outlets as well? Where we open, if you have inlet in back and you let the air out in back, it doesn't cover your body area. It has to cover the body area to take help with evaporation. Considering the protective clothing, we can't just pump in. However, there are pretty effective fans for respiration. It can give 200 liters per minute. So you can filter and blow in certain conditions and get, and those batteries last for 6 hours, if I'm not wrong, maybe today more. So you have a possibility, or if there is a possibility of separate compressed air source. Here we have the study, what we did for a nuclear power plant. We have a ventilated suit, and in this case we had 300 liters per minute or more ventilation. And low activity task, walking, low activity task at 50, and walking at 50. And then one condition, extreme walking 50, where we didn't have so much ventilation. We had around 30 liters per minute. And we can see that activity here, or the temperature here, what is the outer temperature doesn't matter because you get this effect from compressed air. For the same activity at 50 or 40, it's about the same. With the walking, there is a little bit difference in the end. Based on the measurements, we can also calculate the estimated or suggested work times for different temperatures and activity levels. So let's say when they close the reactor and do the first observation, there can be, when they go in, there can be above 55 degrees inside. There they can't use compressed air because they have to move long distances. However, when they do the maintenance, the temperature has come down, and then being inside with this ventilated suit, generally there was no problem for them. They could, I think when they did the maintenance, then the temperature was around there between 35, 40, so they could even with higher workload work for a whole day. And at the same time, with this continuing from the firefighter study, we were looking at different ventilation rates. So we see that body core temperature change at 35 with no flow, 35 with 30 liters per minute, 100 liters per minute, and 45 degrees at no flow, we see the change in core temperature. And the 100 liters is quite much lower compared to others. Now the starting points are different, so if we make them similar, then we see also that already 30 liters per minute gives an effect compared to no ventilation at all. It's also has been tested if part of the if there are higher capacity bottles, if to use part of this bottle air to cool the suit. Let me see this one. In here, they are the channels that lead. So if to use this system, then it should be then air channels built in the suit. So you connect it and you get this cooling air in to different parts, so it covers as big area of the body as possible to take the, help to evaporate and take the moisture and heat away. And depending on the exposure temperatures here, we can see that heat loss difference is at 30, 100, and 180 liters per minute flow rates. If we add also the wet conditions, so if we are like mannequin is totally dry or human is totally dry, the effect is less. However, if it can take away the moisture, then it works quite well. The prediction model for heat, where physiological parameters are taken into account, is ISO 7933 PHS, predicted heat strain. So if we, there was a question about impermeable and permeable, then we see how these different materials, permeability of the materials affects the work time depending on the ambient temperatures. if the temperatures grow much higher than 50, 60 degrees, then it doesn't make much difference anymore because the load is so high. Here is the results of the what we did for analysis for Ebola protection shoot, and of course, depending on impermeable, semi-permeable, or relatively tight but permeable coverall, your exposure times are different for different activity levels, heat generation in the body. But it's also what limits we set for the core temperature. Here is 38, what is the common occupational exposure limit. Limit of reaching 38.5. And then 39. In rescue operations, I think quite often that is 30. You reach 39, and this after race can be even higher. Considering this basic physiological and testing, so in future that information can be used and is already used in various smart solutions. There is in Norway. It has been a project, Smart at Sea, coldware for the people on the fishing ships, but also on the oil platforms. If they fall overboard or any other, how to use it, how the protective clothing is functional for their tasks. It has been European project, Smart at Fire. The risk with this is that you have lots of gadgets that people try to push in, and actually no one has no idea how the data can be used. So in a way, the output of these different measurements should be very simple, and it has to be very clear to whom it goes. If it goes to firefighter, it can be a distraction. Eventually, it can be measured, but sent then to people who are in charge of the operation and are outside and have time to look at it. Operation center. So, but very very often the like this first idea as it is that you get the blinking stuff in the helmet or on the visor, and it may not work. Here is. One work what we have been dealing with, so this is the standard ISO 8996 estimates metabolic rate from heart rate, and it considers different effects. However, it doesn't define how you evaluate those different effects. It is we see here that the metabolic rate itself for different activities, either in heat or room, this is pretty similar. It's in a way within the one standard deviation, no significant difference. While we have circular responses to work in heat, on heart rate, the same activity, it can be close to 40 beats per minute different. It's just the heat effect.
So they've stopped working at this point.
Huh?
Is this being measured while they're working, or
yes,
they have
yes.
stopped working?
No, it is like continuous, and then it's taken the, let's say, 1 minute of the task average.
Okay, yes. So yeah, but one of the things that's been done, and the study that's been done, is that, let's say the firefighter comes out of the fire, they go to rehabilitation, they sit down, they take their heart rate, there's no correlation between that resting heart rate and your body core temperature. None whatsoever. Your heart rate will come right down, and your core will, you'll cook like roast beef. You know, you take the roast beef out, put it on the oven, you know, put it on the side, and it keeps cooking. That's what your body's doing. And so that thermal lag, so I think there's something that needs to be looked at there in terms of...
I show now.
Yeah, okay.
Soon.
Okay.
But first, it was in a way that we... We had the same problem, like you say, that we don't get out what we want. We want it to get from metabolic rate, but we can't correct it. Okay. And then we planned to use that. We are using accelerometers. accelerometers to support heart rate, because when you are moving, then you have it on, but when you're sitting down, there is no. And the initial results were pretty good. So we have the acceleration predictions different. We had in 4 points on the body accelerometers with angular velocity, and we discovered that, okay, we can get a better prediction without heart rate than heart rate, because the heart rate, due to all the stress factors, whatever factors, it disturbed more. On the other hand, then we continued and tried to get a study where we eliminated the effect of different activity. We had people walking on a step machine in a sports hall, and then we increased load but forced them to keep the same pace, and there it went, in a way, blew out, so that it didn't work. Okay. Here is one picture also related to the earlier this cycling, walking, resting, but then we have also adding the second passage or pass, so that when a person having rest after this exposure, the core temperature went up, yes, about 0.5 degree more. Then feeling well at this point, said, okay, I feel okay and can go in, and then managing only 20 minutes. And then stopping himself because saying that, okay, I don't feel that it is good to continue.
Temperature going up even higher the second time.
Yes, but it is also the risk that, in a way, you have still this heat collected in the body, and it continues adding. So eventually, at this level, the person is above that level that says that, okay, it's dangerous. And that case was that he didn't feel that it's dangerous, but it was that I don't know if what is how I feel. I really don't know. I don't feel that it's bad. And then stopping because of that, because it felt insecure.
But our clothes is so good, so they isolated the heat.
Yeah.
And when the heat gets through, it's the same problem to get out.
Yes. Yeah.
You have to take off your clothes.
Yes. But that was the case. He came out and opened up the jacket. But as it's in many cases, you don't take off your boots, you don't take off the pants. Although the most effective would be, you come out, take off the boots, jacket, and put the hands and arms into the cold water. That's the most effective to get quickly rid of the heat. And then we had here the doctoral student for last year was from South Korea, and she was studying the effect of trying to get core temperature out of the heart rate. So now we are addressing the questions. So she was looking at different relationships from the core temperatures and heart rate, and the published papers, looking what the ISO says. It's like you have basic heart rate, you have from metabolic rate, heat storage, stress, and so on. Different factors that affect your heart rate. And she had done part of her studies in Korea with firefighters, and then we did with firefighter and sports clothes, and we see that we have a race, but during the break the heart rate stabilizes. Then in the same heat, they're resting this in heat and then continue. But next time it stabilizes at higher level. So from this relationship, she got her prediction of core temperature by heart rate. So she is just finalizing her PhD on this topic. and has recommendations, resting heart rate criteria, heart rate, and then what it would mean for the core temperature. Of course, again, the span is quite wide. So you have plus minus 0.6 degree. That is quite a lot, but it's still some kind of indication. Yeah. And then also that if you go to work again, then and work 20 or 30 minutes expected from this resting heart rate, then what would be your core temperature after that? So if you have originally 60 and you go and work, then it's after 20 minutes 37.3. And the correction is based on resting heart rate. You have to have seated in a calm conditions at least three minutes to get the values. Or if you want it a little bit better, then you have the heart rate, body weight, and the maximal capacity.
A very interesting study, but not much use as it relates to actual fire ground activity, because there's no way we're going to have that data out in the street. You know, when would you take that data? At the start of every shift? You know, I think there's interesting information there, but I don't know how we can use it practically.
The question is about how many apps you have in your telephone. If it can be, today apps can, or all these gears can easily collect heart rate.
Fair enough, yeah. That's a good observation, yeah.
So it's to make an app based on this. And I would expect that instead of VO2 max, you should look on the personal basal heart rate when you're sleeping or resting, seated rest, and the maximal heart rate. And that have to be updated because it's known that with age, your both maximal VO2 and heart rate comes down. So let's say each year you have new information, and then it's in your personal app, it gives you a feedback.
Yes. How good is the correlation between rectal temperature and the temperature that doctors take with in the ear?
It depends in which conditions they take it.
How would it be post fire ground, so people are coming out of the fire?
I don't recommend that air measurement at all, because your outer air and all that environment affects it. It is, if you have a stable hospital environment, you can use this infrared in the air. There can be again found algorithms. What I showed this disaster medicine study, that we measured esophageal temperature, air canal temperature, and we tried also that one. It was minus 20 degrees. They were laying in wet underwear for 30 minutes, and when help came and wrapped them in, and then when help came, they measured also the air temperature. And if they put the probe in the air, it took about 15 plus minutes when it reached close to this, what we had the other probe inside the air. So your air and body, outer body parts are already so good. The same about the heat. So,
and there's about a 1 degree potential difference between core and ear, right?
More,
yeah. More?
Okay. Yeah.
I had a question down there where the VO2 max, is that related to the individual maximum capacity?
Yes.
How come that, I mean, should be related, I mean, to the work itself, because someone with a higher VO2 max, it's usually be working at a lower heart rate for the same exercise.
I agree. That's why I said that for me it's also a little bit unclear here. Your maximal heart rate doesn't need to be related to your maximal VO2. Sportsmen, quite often, they can have very high VO2 at the same time when their maximal heart rate is maybe 180 only. My personal, I'm not so well trained. I'm in best times it was 218. But at the same time, the same person can have the resting pulse 40, and I have it over 60. So I doubt in this part, but it's also that this is this study, and it has to be looked further.
Because the flow rate, the oxygen flow rate being consumed at that point in time, and not actually the maximum capacity of that person.
You could take the assumption that somebody who has a very high VO2 max is going to simply work harder.
Because then they're equally afraid the heartbeat will be really low at the same time. And once those two go like that, they're balanced, counterbalance.
For the same workload. If you anticipate that.
Well, I assume that this is being done for the same, everybody.
Let's say this part was what was done at our lab. We had that we measured the maximal capacity of each person, and they worked at first at 50% of their maximal, and then 80% of their maximal, and the third pass was 50% of their maximal again. The personal.
And then all of them are doing different. I mean,
the
amount of energy that they're being is completely different. Probably doesn't relate to the bargain.
Behind this is going up the stairs.
Go faster.
You go with your with the other guy. You don't go as fast as you can.
Maybe you don't go as fast as you can.
When it comes to dragging a victim, stronger people will just outperform the less strong people.
Dragging horse, lying, everything. Yeah. I understand what you're saying, but I think that a lot of this is compensated by your work.
In a way, this she tried also his heart rate, but in a way, statistically and all these analyses she did, the best correlation was with VO2. Okay. Yes.
Could you also conclude from these data that it is not so good for firefighters to do anything before they have a call? Because it means that every time you do something, your temperature will rise. Yeah. And if you don't take rest, then the temperature will increase all day. So for example, sports like football, or coming to your job on the bicycle.
You know, I mean, you're leaving out conditioning, you're leaving out like acclimatation. There's a whole bunch of aspects of this that this is very isolated.
Yes, but it was a very short acclimatization, and the temperature rise. So it means that after some.
If I work for 2 weeks on average, it takes about 14 days. If you work about 14 days in the heat, you know, increasing, you can tolerate much more heat, like a lot more heat.
Yes,
okay?
That you can increase that by doing it
in 14 days, 10 to 14 days. The same, you know, cold heat. The body will acclimatize and be more effective in those temperatures.
But if you don't do that, then...
Well, then you're not going to be as effective. You may have a greater spike. Mm-hmm. You know, your body's not accustomed to it. But, I mean, you look at people who work in mines, you know, in Africa, or, you know, they work in that heat, and they can function like you and I could function in the cold, but maybe we went in there, we'd drop like a fly.
You know what I mean?
Just acclimatize.
So if you play football every day, then you can get
fitness, acclimation. There's a number of body fat. There's a number of things.
Yes.
Back in the old day, the Swedish Fire Service, there was like a mandate that you would do a physical workout and then go into the sauna for like 15 minutes. That was to build heat tolerance to be able to sustain stress better. Is that still? That was said to be the best way to maybe fake the way that people working in hot environment all the time to fake that that ability or that customization.
Yeah, acclimatization is always good, and it helps to tolerate. You have more effective sweating. You have less salt lost in sweat. Your heart rate for the same activity keeps lower, so in a way you have possibility to input. But how it is exactly done in Swedish, then maybe Stefan is better person to answer that.
It's not really performed that way anymore, but in old textbooks that was that was said, that you should do this. You should do a physical workout and use sauna afterwards. And I work 10 years full time, and that's what we do still. But that's more because it's nice to work. It's not because I do it to be macho at the time.
Considering these, let's say, military missions now in Iraq and everywhere there, there is many studies when how long it takes, how much you have to do the exercise and acclimatization before you go, before you are allowed for the full duty. So it is in a way, reference is still 10 days of acclimatization. However, if you have been, let's say, a week or two away, you come back, you don't need 10 days. If you need maybe 5 days of acclimatization. If you are away 30 days and more, then it is 10 days acclimatization. You take it easy first 10 days. Generally, already the first 1-2 days improve very much. They are the most tough. So on third, fourth day, it is already easier. But it's not full acclimatization yet, if you start from nothing. So if you do any physical exercise, if you have to have a competition, let's say you are going to marathon to our home country, you don't have sauna or whatever, you put more clothes on and you do your workout in this warm clothes and you get acclimatization. It is like sauna as well. So if you have an access to sauna afterwards, it's adds about. So that's why is well-trained people are better acclimatized, because the body during exercise heats up and you build up some kind of acclimatization anyway.
Another piece of research that's out there is post-fire sauna. And certainly I will restrict this to the North American environment, where I think the body mass index is higher. I could be wrong. I think Europe. I think Europe's following that trend, but the data is that, you know, it's not a good thing to do. If you are suffering from any type of coronary, you know, impediment, it's very dangerous. And you know, that's you know, because there's a big push in the Americas, you know. For post-fire decontamination using sauna, and it's not recommended within 24 hours of a fire, because there's you're already suffering from plasma loss. There's a number of things. You've redlined the engine, if you will, and you're more prone to heart attack. So.
Now I don't know. It may be also cultural, but let's say I have read some reports from China. On sauna general, and then from Finland, and they are totally contradictory, and that can be that those people who take sauna there now and then don't do it so often, so they are not used, so they get more problem when they push themselves suddenly, even though they are maybe acclimatized in southern sauna China, while in Finland they do it is the culture.
Yeah, that's why I restrict it to the Americas, right? And certainly one of the issues in the presentations I've seen is body mass. The people who are dropping are suffering from some form of coronary heart disease, or they have far too much electrolyte, you know, the electrolyte imbalance, you know, a heart disturbance, and then they suffer, you know, either they're carrying too much weight, or because they are unhealthy, too large, they have already a heart condition, or they've dehydrated to the point that they have basically electrolyte imbalance, and that electrolyte, you know, they've rehydrated, they get in the sauna, they again electrolyte imbalance, and they have electrical disturbance, and because they have the underlying heart condition or blockage or whatever, they suffer a coronary.
Considering drinking during the exercise or heat exposure, then it's also that, in a way, when you know or have an idea how much you sweat, then it is that generally you should drink continuously, 300-400 milliliters, depending, each 15-20 minutes. If you drink half liter at once or a liter at once, it doesn't help you. You can absorb, body can absorb. depending on body size, there are 250 to 400 milliliters at once. If you drink more, it in a way you pee it out. And if you think you have drank now a lot, but you have taken it once an hour, whole liter, you have lost it already. It hasn't been, in a way, giving your body this rehydration effect. Yeah, yes. And then you may believe that you are in a good condition, while actually you're not. But generally, I'm finished. I have no conclusions. You have to draw your own conclusions.